Guys, Harsh here, and welcome to another episode of Shout Aloud. And today we have a special guest with us, the guy whom I met 5 years back when I started blogging. And this guy is an author, he's a blogger, he is a speaker, and today we have Mr. Pavan Duggal with us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
With Pavan sir, we'll be talking a lot about legal aspect of the blogging, what are the things that most of us are doing but we are not aware of the legal issues or legal concerns related to the blog. So let's start with a bit about you, how you started as a cyber law expert.
Well, I was a normal civil and corporate lawyer, then got interested in technology law, did some work for some software companies, then internet came along, got fascinated by the medium, and then I wanted to concentrate on this area. It was early days, it was mid-90s, and there was no future, but then I thought this is an area to concentrate on. So slowly started working. There was nothing happening in India, so started working outside India with ICANN. And then the Indian government came up with the Indian cyber law. And since then, one has been pretty much focused on all the emerging issues between cyber law, cyberspace, mobile law, anything to do with law and technology.
Let's talk about the trademark issue with the blog. So every blogger who starts now, they buy a domain name, they have a logo. How important it is for them to trademark their logo and domain name?
For every blogger, the blog is itself the most significant aspect of their online existence. So therefore, we must not take our blogs very, very non-seriously. In fact, we should be very serious about it. We should try to protect the names. We can do the names by trying to apply for a trademark registration. The trademark registration is not very expensive. Will just take you a small amount of money, but will help you to protect your name, because if somebody else would want to lay claim to the rights of that name, then as a blogger, you might find that your legal interests are prejudicially impacted. So I would suggest when you blog, try to have some basic precautions so that others don't touch you, your blogging platforms, and are not able to misuse or unauthorizedly use your blog's name.
If you have a popular blog, you might have missed out, you know, adding the trademark to your blog. And if some XYZ guy comes and he tried to, you know, put a trademark for that particular name, how do you protect yourself in that case?
Well, it's not that if you have a registration for trademark, you can lock out other people. Mm-hmm. Please understand, trademark is the mark under which you do your trade. The law recognizes the fact that there could be a variety of streams of business that you could be working on. So the law has got different classes. So just because you have got a trademark in one class does not mean that you will be able to lock out others in other classes. So let me give an example. Amul is a famous trademark for butter, but Amul is also a registered trademark for a garment company which is into undergarments and vests. So it basically goes to show that the same name can be allocated to different persons for different business activities, and they can still be distinctive. So you will have to be careful that when you apply for your trademark name, it should be in what particular capacity or what category. I think it should be in the category pertaining to internet, pertaining to computers, so that's where your online presence is going to be.
So, and this is also very important for the e-commerce website especially.
Oh yes, if you're doing anything e-commerce, please, you must as a first instance go ahead and protect your name. And all that we are asking you to say is, please go and register with the registrar of trademarks. Apply and forget about it. The law is very clear. The day you apply, your protection begins. In India, getting a trademark will normally take some time, maybe a few years as well. So that does not mean that you will stop doing business or stop doing some e-commerce transactions. You apply for your trademark, and the law says the day you apply, your protection begins.
All the pages, all the e-commerce website or the blogs, people say that you need to have privacy policy page, comment policy page. How important they are from the viewpoint of law?
These things are absolutely important from the viewpoint of law. In fact, I would like to emphasize that all bloggers and all blogging platforms need to appreciate that they are intermediaries under the law. Now you will say, I'm only doing blogging, I'm not doing any activity. Yes, you're not doing any activity, but as a blogger, you're creating content and you're putting it up on a blogging platform. When you do so, you become a content service provider, a network service provider, and hence you become an intermediary. The moment you become an intermediary, under the Indian IT law, which is the information technology law. Then the Indian cyber law says you must exercise due diligence while you discharge your obligations as a blocker. So the law says please have your terms and conditions, have rules and regulations, have privacy policy, have disclaimers, which will actually inform your users that they will not post any information on your blog which is patently defamatory, derogatory, or which is violating any law, or which violates any intellectual property rights, or which is aimed to ridicule or annoy someone. Absolutely, the law says your due diligence parameters include having these terms and conditions, the rules and regulations, privacy policies for your website, so please have it. If you think that you cannot author it yourself, look at some important ones and take some salient features and then put them on your website. Ideally, it would be best if you can go through a lawyer, because a lawyer will be able to actually protect you and protect your interests. But make sure that when you do a cut and paste, ensure that the names of the source from where you've done cut and paste do not find mention on your blog. I've done a case where a blogger put the terms and conditions of Yahoo on his own blog. And the terms and conditions all said that Yahoo will do this and Yahoo will do that. So I think when you do a cut and paste, you have to be very, very careful, and we tell it.
Blogging has changed a lot. Now blog makes good money. I mean, it makes huge money. So how important it is for a blogger to treat their blog like a business? Do they have to go through some process, or I mean, it's like, you know, my personal blog where I'm making maybe $1,000 a month and it's all good, all right?
Well, when you're doing blogging as a serious activity, you'll have to quickly realize it's a very serious e-commerce transactional business, number one. Number two, when you're doing things seriously, please ensure that your blog is on the right side of the law. Why? Because any one loose comment anywhere on your blog and your entire blog could be in trouble. Number two, you have to realize that in Indian cyber law, we have a provision, which is section 66A, that becomes peculiarly dangerous for bloggers. Because this section makes it an offense when somebody sends, using a computer or a mobile phone, any information that's grossly offensive or menacing in character. Which means anybody, whether it's the blogger himself or whether it's somebody who's posting a comment on the blog, if that particular person is writing, publishing content, sending content that's grossly offensive or menacing in character, the blogger better be careful, because a criminal case can be registered both against the guy who left the comment and also the blogger under section 66A of the IT Act. This gets you 3 years jail time and fine. So you will have to be very, very careful when you do your blogging activities.
Basically, bloggers should take care of the comment moderation and should filter out everything that is going on in his blog, because he's the responsible guy for the blog itself.
Absolutely, a blogger is responsible for his blog, so it's a responsibility of the blogger to ensure that there is due diligence. He does not put up any comment which is in violation of the law or which is in any case incriminating either the blogger or the concerned publisher of the content. So you will have to be careful.
In recent time, we have seen a great increment in the rise of social media, like Facebook, Twitter, and people are becoming social media influencers. I mean, anyone from their house become a overnight celebrity. What are the things this online celebrity should know about the law, cyber law especially, that might put them out of the trouble?
Well, if you are an online celebrity, or if you have become an online celebrity, be very careful of what you do online. Primarily because if you publish any content online which is in violation of the law, for example, which is obscene, then that gets you into trouble. You publish content which you know is false, but which has been sent for the purposes of causing annoyance, inconvenience, hatred, ill will, or enmity, that also could land you into trouble. Basically, if you're an online celebrity, the thumb rule is never do any activity online whenever you are in an emotional state of mind. Why? Because you're more likely than not to actually commit mistakes. And you have to quickly realize that internet is a big data dragon with infinite memory. Whatever you're going to put on the internet will be there for a long, long period of time. And because you're an online celebrity, you'll have to be extremely careful of what you publish, what you transmit. Just one off-the-cuff remark could land you into controversy, into legal exposure, and could potentially impact your future as an online celebrity.
So one has to be very careful what he puts on social, Facebook or Twitter. each and every word matters here.
Absolutely. Each word, each character matters now in the age of the Twitter.
Alright. So, now one question that, you know, we Indian bloggers especially, like we have, though we blog from India, but our web hosting, the website which is hosted, is usually on the US server.
Mm-hmm.
So, we come under jurisdiction of which country? Are we like...
A lot of bloggers believe that because their blogging platforms are hosted on US servers, they are not amenable to Indian law. I think that's a fallacy. That's a completely false perception. If you are a blogger who's in India, who's using a computer system or a communication device which is physically located in India, then you become amenable under the Indian cyber law. It's of no consequence that your blog is located or hosted on a server outside the country. So long as your blog is read or is impacting computers, computer systems or networks physically located in India, you become amenable to Indian law.
What about the images on the blog? So we have this habit, I mean, if I'm not mistaken, there was a big case against Times of India where they used the image of Twilight Fairy, an Indian blogger, back in 2008 somewhat. But now, the number of bloggers are rising. Everyone needs images and they just go to Google and copy them from Google. So what are the legal implications of using images like that?
It's very important for you to be careful when you select the images you want to use on your blog. Why? Just don't do a blind random copy paste from the internet. Just because information is available on the internet does not mean that you could use it. There is now some websites which allow you free images.
Stock.
You can, or stock images. You can go through them and use them. If you really want to use somebody else's image, please realize that that somebody else's image is a copyrightable photograph, is artistic or a cinematographic work that actually belongs to somebody else in terms of its copyright rights. So therefore, before picking out any such copyrighted picture, please write an email to the concerned person asking for permission to use it. If you get the permission, you can then use it. Alternatively, write an email, wait for 36 hours and then put up the picture, but please put up below the picture that the said copyright of the picture belongs to so-and-so, the source. So long as you are being transparent and so long as you're not actually commercially exploiting the photographs, it's fine, because it's part of fair use if you can actually give exact acknowledgement of the source of the picture. But if you want to pick up those pictures and utilize it for commercial benefit, then you quickly realize that you will come under the law. The Copyright Act will go after you, and you could be exposed to two kinds of liability. There could be imprisonment and fine. There could also be exposure to injunction and damages. So be very, very careful. A small reckless activity for pertaining to an image could actually cost you a lot in the coming times.
In November, you're hosting International Cyber Law Summit. So can you tell more about the summit? What exactly I can expect, or people like me can expect from the summit?
There's large number of ambiguity today, what exactly is in cyber law, cyber crime and cyber security. So basically, to address these ambiguities, to identify what are the emerging trends on cyber law, cyber crime and cyber security, cyberlaws.net and Pavan Duggal Associates is organizing the international conference on cyber law, cyber crime and cyber security. This is basically going to be a one-day event which will keep you up to date as to what is happening on these various issues in these complicated scenarios. Why? Because there are going to be 5 plenary sessions, there are going to be 12 parallel sessions, and you can pick and choose any subject you would want to go, and you will have the top people from the industry. We'll have international speakers coming and talking, and most significantly, you get an opportunity to specifically interact with the creme de la creme. So I believe if you're a blogger, I will actually encourage you that you should come for this particular conference, because this conference in one single day is going to make you up to date as to what are the latest challenges that cyber law, cyber crime and cyber security we are facing, and what as bloggers you need to be careful of. And this is happening in Delhi on 20th of November. So look forward to having all of you bloggers coming for the said conference.
Alright, so I look forward to it. One question, like, I'm in your office and the interesting thing, sponsor, he has like 4 laptops, one Toshiba, one HP, and then one MacBook. Now the question is, how do you manage this 4 laptop and how do you manage your time with this 4 laptops?
Well, you see, one has got different laptops because there are different functions assigned for stuff. So some clients are very, very finicky. They want us to only work in Apple and not work in any other system. So So for those, you only have to work in Apple. So there is one computer that's not connected to the internet, but that's got all the information. Then there is a general working computer, and then there's a specific another computer. So I think we divide our different baskets of work and of the data that we have, and depending on what the requirement is, then we use it. Because if you are going to randomly put all our data into one particular computer and everything's up there, you're putting all your eggs in one particular basket. So it's best to, when you're dealing with confidential information, to keep it as separate as you can.
That's great. So that brings me to this question. Since you are an expert in this field, I'm sure you must be using so many layers of protection, security on the laptop. What are the things that you would recommend to an end user to use on their laptop?
Okay. First and foremost, I would suggest don't use the laptop as it is. Because a lot of time people believe, I have picked up the laptop, it's ready to use, I'll plug in, I'll start using. No, that's not the case. Please make sure that your laptop must have some basic minimum levels of security. And a good way to get started is having a good antivirus program. There are a lot of free antivirus programs available, you can utilize them. There are some licensed ones, you can use them. But quickly realize that antivirus is not really a guarantee to security. Antivirus has got certain predetermined definitions through which it's going to actually check the data packets to say, well, does it match in the form of, is it a virus or is it not? But nowadays, you have to quickly realize that security is a much bigger ball game altogether. So have a good antivirus, have a good firewall, so as to ensure that unauthorized intrusion does not take place on your system. Wherever possible, if you're dealing with sensitive information, please do not connect the said sensitive information to the internet, because you do not know at what point of time the laptop is going to be hacked. We've seen cases where the camera of the laptop has been hacked to capture the subject in various forms of undress, or to capture the contents of a meeting, a corporate meeting that's happening. So hackers are today taking on to cybercrime as a way of living. So they are going to hack and do anything possible so as to legitimately deprive you of the benefits of your confidential data. So be very secure, try to make your data secure, and try to have good working hygiene habits when you're talking about electronic format. I believe if you do these basic precautions, to a large extent, you can protect yourself from being a potential victim to cybercrime.
So you have seen the growth, inception of internet in India, online marketing, e-commerce, blogging altogether. What are the things that you would like to tell them so that will help them throughout in the career?
I think internet is a fabulous medium to be on. You got life of opportunities in front of you. However, I would want that when you are on the internet, be very careful, because when you do any activity on the internet, you leave your electronic footprints behind. Do not leave anything which is incriminating, which could land you into trouble. So if you're an entrepreneur, if you're a blogger, if you're running an e-commerce website, or if you're just about any stakeholder in the digital or mobile ecosystem, utilize the positives of this particular ecosystem to the best of your benefit and advantage. Ensure that you do not commit any criminal activities. Also ensure that your platforms do not become the fertile grounds for hosting criminal activities, and ensure that you do not transmit, publish, or cause to be transmitted or published in the electronic form any information which is in violation of the law. For that, it's important that you must be broadly aware of the broad parameters of the law. Because they say ignorance of law is no excuse in the eyes of law, it's always better that you and your activities online are on the right side of the law. Have your documented compliances in place so that next time there's a problem, there's a knock on your door by the police, you get a summons from a court of law. At least you will have the requisite legal proofs to show that you, your operations are compliant with the law and yet you have not contravened the law. I believe it's best to be safe, best to keep your data safe. And I think once you and your data is safe, surely that's opening up the doorway for a safe, secure future for all of you.
Alright, thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Sure, pleasure meeting you.